Welcome to KCF's online church service. We're glad you've joined us. Please remember to like and subscribe.
Celebrating their birthdays this week. On the 5th, Rebecca Johnson, Ernest Wilkin. On the 4th, Roger Duploy, Nelisa Ngube, Shahid Skiepers, Benice Shirto. On the 3rd, Amaro Bart, Abel Hlongwane. On the 2nd, Shekinah Bryan, Spamanla Hlasweo, Joshua Jordan. On the 1st, Margaret Jordan, Sean Knutze, Hazel Naidu, Mita Takalo. On the 30th, Maggie Hall, Alita Cock, Bonnie Nzenga. And celebrating today, Gerald Damon, Osas Iweka. Celebrating their anniversaries this week, on the 5th, Michael and Gwen Tyler. On the 4th, Gareth and Naomi Doyle. On the 3rd, Garen and Alicia Pillay. On the 1st, Keith and Lucy Barnabas. On the 30th, Roland and Janetta Barker, Rian and Susan Van Veek.
Once upon a time, in a kingdom far, far away.
Wrong story. By the time you finish, Christmas would have come and gone.
Really?
Speaking of Christmas, did you know that the Wasp Bucket Project is taking place as planned this year?
Yeah, I heard about it. Apparently, they want to bless about 300 families who still haven't recovered from the aftermath of COVID-19.
That's so cool. So how can we get involved?
So we actually urge you, family or cell family, to get together and do a few buckets.
That sounds interesting. How do we get hold of a bucket?
So buckets are available. You can either speak to Leanne, Charles or Gila. We provide a bucket and a shopping list. Each costs about 180 to 200 rand per bucket.
But you know, shopping is a bit of a strain.
So if you don't want to pick up a bucket and do shopping yourself, you also have an option of just donating the cost of a bucket to the Wasp bank account.
Well, I guess it's a sacrifice. No more KFC and McDonald's for the next few weeks. But like they say, we are blessed to be a blessing.
South Africa faces many formidable challenges. However, the most insidious of these are the assaults on the health and innocence of children. What am I talking about? Well, comprehensive sexuality education, or CSE. The frightening reality we face today is that education has given way to sexual indoctrination. So what are the goals of CSE and who are the groups behind it? First, there is Planned Parenthood, the US largest abortion provider. CSE is a means to transform gender roles and advance equitable social systems. Then there is a Sexuality Information Council of United States, whose primary objective is to use sex ed for social change. The South African government signed onto CSE at a meeting organized by Western European governments and attended by United Nations agencies like UNESCO. Alarmingly, no South African education or parent groups were invited to participate in this meeting. Tragically, despite overwhelming public opposition, the DBE, guided and instructed by UNESCO, is pushing ahead with CSE, despite government repeatedly calling for African solutions for African problems. Significantly, however, in a Q&A session in Parliament 2019, Basic Education Minister Angie Motshekga confirmed CSE is not compulsory. She added, parents can use alternative sexuality education programs as long as it was CAPS compliant. The solution to this crisis and the best way to protect vulnerable children from the dangerous sexual indoctrination embedded in CSE is to provide a safe, credible, and gender-free sexuality education alternative based on traditional and common sense values. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. That new model is Smart Choices. Smart Choices is part of Smart Life, a multi-level educational package for educators, parents, caregivers, teachers, and counselors. It teaches children of all ages to make smart choices for a smart life. The program provides guidance to protect against relationship and sexual abuse. Smart Life is an acronym for Sexuality Mentoring, AIDS, Relationship Training, Life Skills, and Family Education. It is supplemented by excellent educational and training programs for parents and educators called No Apologies, Not Guilty, and Tomorrow's Leaders in Training. These programs offer critical guidelines for the training of children in various age groups. Smart Choices and the supplementary programs are values-based. They adopt a sexual health, wellness, and character-building approach to sexuality education. In contrast, CSE takes a sexual rights approach to sexuality education, thereby driving a wedge between children and their parents. You can help protect children from harmful sexual indoctrination by sharing this video widely and encourage educators and parents to adopt the Smart Choices programs. If you are a parent of school-going children, urge your child's school to order the values-based Smart Choices programs to equip them to safely navigate the minefield of conflicting sexuality information in our culture. If you are an educator, please urge your learning institution to consider adopting the Smart Choices programs to ensure all school-age children are provided the critical life skills they need to make smart choices. These programs are developed by South African educators for South African children. Do the right thing. Stop sexual indoctrination of South African children by global abortion and sexual rights radicals. Adopt the safe and reliable Smart Choices curriculum for a smart life.
So now that we've discussed all the other matters, all our work matters, maybe we should discuss the 6th of December.
Oh, wow. Okay, 6th of December is our 10th year takeover service. Wow, what a great achievement.
10 years, can you imagine?
I know. So, seeing that it's 10 years, what do we have planned for takeover service this year?
So, I was thinking it's a celebration. 10 years, it marks a milestone. And I was thinking that it would be such an awesome concept to be able to have all the youth that has been part of YMAT for 10 years.
Yes.
And you know what, maybe they're no longer in the church or they've left, but still we could be able to contact them and ask them to share a little testimony of how YMAT had made some sort of impact in their lives and their experience at YMAT. And that will encourage many other young people out there. What do you think of that idea?
I think it's a brilliant idea. Thank you, guys. I think it was a great initiative. I think, you know, what they're going to share will be such so impactful to so many young people and also so many of the parents, you know, that bring their kids to youth.
Yes.
And actually get to see, you know, where they come from and where they're heading to. I think it's a great idea. Well done to the team.
So we call it This Is My Testimony.
Absolutely.
But on another note,
yeah,
we have Pastor's Appreciation as well.
Oh, wow. Yeah, you know, two things to celebrate on the 6th of December. And the first week of December we look forward to is our takeover service and pastor's appreciation. And why do we appreciate our pastor is because he goes the extra mile for his congregation and his people. You know, people believe that the pastor's job starts and ends on a Sunday morning in front of the pulpit. But let me tell you guys, it's far from true. You know, I remember the one time where Pastor Morgan himself, you know, he did a funeral in the morning,
and then
he'd come and go and do a birthday party in the afternoon. I thought it was, you know, it can be so emotionally drained on any person. I asked myself, you know, how can man, you know, just a mere man, go through that emotion today? And I was so grateful that, you know, God has placed him in our church, in our community, in our lives to take care of us. And the pastor appreciates, it's just something for us to say thank you. Yeah, thank you for all that you've done. Thank you, you know, for all that you do. The many sacrifices that you make, you know, he leaves his family, leave their functions and, you know, can see to us. Whatever we need, pick up the phone and he's there to help us. So, you know, pastor appreciation is just a small token of appreciation to our pastor. We have no obligation whatsoever, you know, to do anything for him. That's what it is, pastor appreciation. So
you just say thank you,
thank
pastor.
Thank you. And it is maybe for our KCF members and family.
Okay.
But those that are watching online and feel that they want to bless the pastor in any way, they're more than welcome to. But this mainly goes out to all our KCF people. We just need to say thank you, Pastor Robin. Thank you, Pastor Valencia, for all that you do, for the many sacrifices you guys make for us throughout the year. We want to say thank you in this way and say, you know, just want to bless you with a small token of appreciation. I know my pastor, it's COVID, and he would say don't do it because, you know, people are going through a difficult time. Yes, people are going through a difficult time, but because you're my pastor and because, you know, you're our pastor and we appreciate you, we as leaders in the church felt that we need to show our appreciation.
Just to say thank you.
Absolutely. So people, please, absolutely no obligation. Don't be compelled to do this. It's pastor appreciation. Whatever you can give towards our pastor, he will be truly, truly grateful and blessed.
So coming back to the 6th is the YMAT takeover service.
Pastor appreciation.
So we'll see you on the 6th.
Come prepared. Come ready to be blessed with the young people. Got an amazing Sunday morning plan for you guys.
They say, wash your hands. Or sanitize. And wear the face mask.
I'm mad. thank you, Lord, that we are not dependent on man, but we are dependent on your Spirit this morning. Come on.
Not my mind. Well, welcome to all those who are watching online this morning. Grace and peace to you in Jesus' name. Shall we pray for the word this morning? Our mighty God and Heavenly Father, give us revelation this morning, give us wisdom this morning, and help us to take heed to what your prophetic word is saying this morning to each and every one of us. I ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to get straight into the word this morning, and my message is entitled, A Famine is on the Horizon. A Famine is on the Horizon. And my sermon is taken from the book of Amos, and I'm going to be reading from chapter 8, verses 11 to 13. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord God, that I will send a famine on the land. Not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but shall not find it. In that day the fair virgins and strong young men shall faint from thirst. Let me give you a little bit of a context to what is happening and the prophetic word that the prophet Amos is giving to the children of God. See, God's judgment on Israel was because of their disobedience and their unholy practices as a chosen people. God had given them a standard, the word of God, by which they ought to be living. And so in this vision, in this prophetic word, the prophet Amos says that there was going to be death all around, that songs of joy will be turned into howlings and wailing because of the dead bodies that will be strewn about everywhere. In view of such death and devastation, the only fitting response will be mourning and silence. Then God addresses the business people, you know, those who are obsessed with oppressing the poor. And while they were oppressing the poor, they were also involved in religious activities. And during those religious activities, they were not permitted to buy or to sell. Their hearts were not involved in these religious activities and these religious observances. Their hearts was when the service was going to be over, so they can get back to go and engage in selling their goods and oppressing the hopeless and the poor and the helpless and the needy. They were defrauding the poor by using scales that do not weigh honestly, while at the same time they were inflating the prices. The whole goal was to enslave the poor and the needy. And they even stooped to the dead to so low that even the poor quality wheat, which they would normally either throw away or give to the poor, they were even selling those things, you know, to make money and to oppress the poor even further. And God says he will never forget the deeds of the oppressors and those who took advantage of the poor. He says he will pour judgment against the land. The judgment will be so severe that there will be no occasion for joy. The people will die everywhere. The festivals that normally, you know, bring times of rejoicing and celebration will be turned into times of mourning. And the songs normally, songs of expressions of joy and celebration will be turned into lamentations and songs of sadness. And the judgment will be so intense that it will be like somebody mourning the only son that they had. And so God gives us this picture, you know, that where people will be with sackcloth and ashes, and, you know, there will be people all, you know, around who have shaven heads and will be just sitting in the deepest of mourning and crying and weeping, and it'll be days of bitterness and sorrow. And then in the midst of all these things, in verses 11 to 14, the prophet says that there is going to come a famine. Not of bread, not of water, but a famine of the word of God. A famine that was going to, you know, cause us not to have the written word, not to hear the written word. You know, the Bible is, God has given us His Word, and from time to time, you know, you find that the children of God, you know, chose not to listen to God's Word. And God always relented, and God always forgave, and God always, you know, had compassion, and He always, you know, kind of came back and loved His people and directed them and showed them, you know, the right way. But there comes a time when the prophet Amos says there is going to be a famine of the word. Amen. And so this morning, you know, going on to from verses 11, it talks about how people are going to be running to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. People will be like wandering around like drunkards, you know, wandering in every direction and looking and searching for the word of God, but it will not be found. Even the most promising women, they call them the fair virgins, you know, those honest, those sincere women, those women that, you know, earnestly desire to hear God's word, even they will not find God's word. Even the young men, the strong young men, you know, will become weary from the hunger and thirst for God's word, and they will faint. So God's warning is that there is a famine on the horizon. Hallelujah. And so I want to this morning, you know, just remind us that the Word of God is there to warn us of what is going to happen. And so, you know, many of us don't have a clue, especially as South Africans in our generation. We have never experienced a severe famine, and we have no idea of what it is like. And so I, went into the, I Googled for the famines in the world, and I found the worldatlas.com website, which lists all the world's deadliest famines. And I found something that was very interesting, and I began to understand what God was saying to me when you were saying there was going to be, there's a famine of the word on the horizon. And so listen to this great Chinese famine that was recorded for us in 1959. It says, the deadliest famine in history took place in China between 1959 and 1961. This catastrophe has been referred to as one of the greatest man-made disasters. Though regional droughts did play a part, the famine was caused by a combination of political and social factors brought about by the People's Republic of China. These policies, namely the Great Leap Forward, which began in 1958, and the people's communes, created a deadly environment that cost tens of millions of lives. These policies included drastic changes to farming policy and prohibited farm ownership. Additionally, peasants were redirected from agriculture in favor of iron and steel production, reducing farm outputs drastically. All of this led to a significant reduction in China's grain production and a widespread food shortage. While governments reported some 15 million deaths, experts agree that the death toll was significantly higher, with numbers ranging anyway from 20 to 50 million people who would have most probably died. You know, right now we have another man-made pandemic in the world that has cost the lives of hundreds of thousands of people all over the world, which emanated from China. It is no coincidence that China is busy rewriting the Bible and the Quran to reflect socialist values. Socialist values. In an article that I read, Beijing said all translated classic religious books should be re-evaluated. The new editions must not contain any content that contradicts socialism. Paragraphs deemed wrong by censors will be amended or retranslated. So when God says there will be a famine of the world, I believe that this time is going to result, not that God is going to bring the famine, but it's going to be a combination of, once again, of political and social economic factors and the agenda of the one world religion, where we will no longer have the Bible as our word, as our law, as our guidance for life, but we will have a man-made laws. We will have a man-made Bible that the whole world will have to abide by. Can you imagine a day where there is no Bible, no preacher to preach the word, no hope, no encouragement, no guidance, no direction from God's word for the children of God, no moral standards to live by, no conviction, no repentance, no salvation, no deliverance, no healings, no miracles? What a dreadful day that would be. Well, to many it may seem unimaginable, and I can understand why. Because never before in the history of mankind were there such free access to God's word. The word of God is available in almost every language in the world, and in many easy to read translations as well. But over the years, there has been a progressive move to digitize, and most of us prefer the electronic copy of the Bible, which has numerous benefits and advantages. So let me just ask you a question. How many of you still carry a physical Bible? How many of you own a physical Bible? How many of you use an electronic copy of the Bible? I do most of the time, because it's convenient. You know, it's with us. We have it on our phone. We can read it anywhere, anytime, because we have our phones with us, or our electronic devices with us. So if we progressively eventually move to everything, be electronic or to a digital platform, well, the written copy of the Bible will become obsolete, and there will be no reason to print written copies of the Bible, which means that we will become totally dependent on an electronic copy, which will be stored in the cloud. Because even with storing on our devices today, the devices are getting to a place where we no longer have to store all our stuff on our devices. It's now all stored in the cloud. Now I want you to just think about this. If the big tech companies collude together, which they have been doing a lot of late, and delete all the electronic copies from the cloud, we will be in serious trouble. Considering how they are currently censoring social media content and taking away our religious freedoms. You know, the average person knows about these things, but they do nothing about it. Amen? You know, they say if you take a frog and you put it in a pot of water and slowly start to heat that water, the frog, instead of jumping out of the water, which it can, will slowly adjust to the water temperature until it is too late and it gets cooked in that boiling water. You know, sometimes what we don't realize is that we are becoming like that. You know, we're only going to wake up one day when it is too late. And God's word is a warning to us. There is a famine of the word on the horizon. Consider how corrupt our world has become. The world doesn't want to hear the word of God because it reveals a true condition of a person. It reveals a true condition of their heart. And this makes them feel very uncomfortable. Think about the religious corruption that we have in this world. The fake preachers, the fake Christians, and worldly churches who are looking to entertain the people and preach what their itching ears want to hear. There's no fear of God. You know, that awesome fear of God that motivates us to turn from evil is no longer there. Many suffer from spiritual malnutrition, influenced by materialism, immorality, and a lack of truth spiritually. The Bible says, "My people perish because of a lack of knowledge." This morning, God is warning you, there is a famine of the word on the horizon. And God says, like newborn babies longing for their mother's milk, we need to be craving for the word of God. Now, I challenge every one of you to make the commitment never to neglect the reading of the word of God. Feast upon it daily. You know, be like the psalmist says, "Your word have I hidden in my heart so that I may not sin against thee. We need to have the word of God in our hearts and in our minds. Feast upon the word daily, which can save your soul. Abide by his commands. You know, one of the American presidents, Theodore Roosevelt, said, a thorough knowledge of the Bible is worth more than a college education. Because the scriptures tell us where man comes from and where he is going. The scripture tells us how to live, how to prevent heartache from coming into your life, how to live a life, you know, to please God and to have a blessed, abundant life. The scripture tells us of Jesus Christ, who was the Redeemer of mankind, and how he came into the world to save us from our sins, to save us from eternal death, and to give us eternal life. Came to show us what heaven is like, what our Father in heaven is like, and what his plan and purpose for us is. Pay attention, children of God. Listen and hear what God is saying. There is a famine of the word on the horizon. God wants his people to know there is a famine coming. Jesus said in Matthew 4 verse 4, as he was answering the devil, he says, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Are you living on the word of God? You know, we are blessed in our day to have an abundance of good biblical preaching. There are preachers all around us who are preaching the truth to the people of God. You know, when the truth is heard and heeded, God will bless his people. God will bless you and in great ways. Hallelujah. When that truth is rejected, God will abandon you to your choice. You see, God doesn't force us. God didn't make us robots. He's given us choice to choose what is right and what is wrong, to choose to serve him. He's not going to force us. And he will abandon us to our own choices. You know, the average church member does not know the books of the Bible. They don't know the Ten Commandments. They don't even know how to share the gospel with unbelievers. Yet they know how to argue against the standards and the word of God. True believers in the past died for the word of God. You know, it was a crime, you know, for people to possess a Bible. You know, there were times where people, you know, were sharing portions of the Bible with one another because there was a famine of the Bible. You know, you as a Christian, you was in a dangerous position if you possessed a Bible. Multitudes of people perished because of the Bible through beatings. They were burned. They were hanged. They were tortured because they were preaching the word of God and holding on to the word of God. Many were slain with Bibles tied around their necks. In the book of Revelation, we read that the Apostle John was banished to the island of Patmos because of the word of God. And in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 9, it says, I, John, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Hear what it says, for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. The prophecy of Revelation goes on to tell us a great company of believers will live and die for the word of God, a martyrdom which is to be repeated in these last days. Are you going to be one of those martyrs? Are you going to be one of those who will never give up the word of God, will stand up for the word of God, will defend the word of God, and will not be afraid to boldly confess and say that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior? In Revelation chapter 6 and verse 9, the Bible says, when he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who have been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? You know, people are crying out, Lord, when are you going to come? When are you going to deliver? When are you going to save? When are you going to come back and take us to be with him? But we need to stand up for the word of God. And so it says in verse 11, then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer until both the number of the fellow servants and the brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. Hallelujah. So there is coming a time where there are going to be men and women of God who are going to be martyred because of the faith. They're going to be standing firm, not giving up, not giving in. The question is, will you be one of them? Or will you be one that is going to hide and give up the word of God? Children of God, let us not forsake the assembling of the saints. Let us come together for the reading of the word. For where two or three come together in my name, Jesus said, there in the midst I am. Hallelujah. In Acts 2:42, it talks about the disciples who devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. We need to get ourselves back, you know, to a place where we prioritize the importance of, you know, meeting together, reading the word together, having fellowship, praying, breaking bread together. You know, some of us are so caught up in our world. We're so busy in our own things and we don't give priority to the things of God. And so in Hebrews 10:37 it says, for in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. I encourage you to remain faithful, children of God. Study the word of God. Read the word of God. Meditate on the word of God. I encourage you to make sure that you have a copy of the word of God. Buy one for your children. Buy one for your grandchildren. Make sure that we have a copy, because tomorrow, if the electronic copies are lost, would you have one that you could read? And so let me close with this scripture found in Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 6 and 7. It says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Wherever you are this morning, I encourage you, ask God to forgive you for your lack of passion and zeal for his word. Ask God to forgive you for the lack of reading his word and meditating on his word. Ask God to forgive you for the lack of for not assembling, you know, with the saints and not getting together and finding every excuse not to be with the children of God. Children of God, I want to say to you, there is a famine on the horizon. And God wants to know this morning, will you stand up for his word? Let's pray. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, I thank you for this word, mighty God. And I thank you, Lord, that even as you've spoken to me about the famine that is on the horizon, I pray for all those who have heard this word this morning, that they will take heed. And may they, Father God, stand up for you, stand up for your word, stand up for the church. And Father God, I pray through the power of the Holy Spirit, you'll give each one boldness and courage, wisdom and understanding, that Lord, Father God, that they will not perish because of a lack of knowledge, but mighty God, that they will stand firm till the end. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, God bless you, and I pray this word has encouraged you, and it's blessed to hear the word, but it'll be even more blessed if you hear the word and do what it says. God bless you. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining us today. For more videos and more content, please press the subscribe and like button. Have a blessed week.